We begin our worship today by words of confession and hearing God's words of forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Amen. Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sins. Reconciling God, we confess that we do not trust your abundance, and we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hope in ourselves, and we rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you provide enough for all, and we abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear different, and we do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us. Through your love, renew us, and in your Spirit, lead us, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. Beloved of God, by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace with God through Christ Jesus, through whom we have obtained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us now live in hope, for hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen.
First readings, 1 Kings 19, 9 through 18. At Horeb, the Mount of God, Elijah came to the cave and spent the night there. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away. He said, go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. Now there was a great wind so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks in pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind, and after the wind an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in the mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. And when there came a voice to him that said, what are you doing here, Elijah? He answered, I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophet with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away. Then the Lord said to him, go return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael as king over Aram. Also, you shall anoint Hazael, son of Nishai, as king over Israel. And you shall anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat of Abel-Mesola, as prophet in your place. Whoever escapes from the sword of Hazael, Zu shall kill, and whoever escapes from the sword of Hazael, Elisha shall kill. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, and all knees that have bowed to him to bow, and every mouth of them shall not kiss him.
The first reading is from Psalm 85, verses 8 through 13. I will listen to what the Lord God is saying, for you speak peace to your faithful people and to those who turn their hearts to you. Truly, your salvation is very near to those who fear you, that your glory may dwell in our land. Steadfast love and faithfulness have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Faithfulness shall spring up from the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven. The Lord will indeed grant prosperity, and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness shall go before the Lord, and shall prepare for God a pathway. The Word of the Lord. The second reading comes from Romans chapter 10, verses 5 through 15. Moses writes concerning the righteousness that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that comes from faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is, to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the abyss, that is, to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart, and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth, and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame, for there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all, and generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they to call on one in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in one of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone to proclaim him? And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of him who brings good news. The end of the reading.
The Holy Gospel according to the Gospel of Matthew in the 14th chapter. Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up to the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but by this time the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, Jesus came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Peter answered Jesus, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." Jesus said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught Peter, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The Gospel of the Lord. A pretty well-known story from the Bible, right? Jesus walking on the water, Peter jumping in and can't swim, to be battered by the waves and then panics. It's a story that's recorded in three of the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and John. Luke leaves it out for some reason. In Matthew's Gospel, as we read that one today, it follows a lot of action on the part of Jesus. Jesus starts out by telling a lot of sermons, a lot of stories, and particularly at the beginning, around the chapter 11, he tells the stories and parables about little faith, mustard seeds that grow big, and things of that nature. And so he ends this section talking about faith. But a lot of things happen in between. Jesus is followed by crowds every day. People want him to heal them, to teach them, to perform miracles. And at one point, Jesus winds up in front of his family. And his family doesn't understand. His family wants him to go away. They want to get rid of him too. Even to the point in his own hometown, they want to try to stone him and put him to death. And he leaves and escapes there. He winds up in our story from last week's gospel, feeding 5,000 people. And he did that right after his cousin, his mentor, his guide, his predecessor, John the Baptist, was killed and martyred by King Herod. He never even got a chance to grieve. Now Jesus has finished feeding the 5,000 and, probably exhausted, sends the crowds away, sends the disciples away, puts them on a boat so they can go across the lake, across the Sea of Galilee to the other side, and he will meet them there. He needed a little R&R, so to speak. He goes up into the mountains. He prays. He has time with Abba, his father. Then he shows up the next morning, and there are the disciples, way over in the middle of the lake. They've had trouble all night long with the wind battering the boat, and they can't make any progress. And off they go as they see Jesus on the shore, and Jesus decides to go greet them. Jesus, he starts walking toward them, and they get terrified. They think they're seeing a ghost. Let's stop right there for a moment. In the early Greek literature, one of the things that happened was when they told stories about ghosts, the word in the Greek is phantom, specter, spirit. And so in this sense, those kind of apparitions, a ghost, didn't walk on water. A ghost could not be on or near water. So for Matthew to have the disciples talk about Jesus being a ghost would really alarm his readers. Why? Because the only entities, the only physical beings, the only pieces of creation that could walk on water were gods. Matthew and Mark are saying that Jesus is the Son of God. So when the disciples are all in the boat, Jesus and Peter get back in the boat, they proclaim that Jesus is the Son of God because they saw him walking on the water. What a way to find out that Jesus is God. It's the first time in the Gospel of Matthew that Jesus has been proclaimed as the Son of God, particularly by the disciples. They've come to see Jesus in a new understanding, in a new way. They didn't see it as Jesus was teaching. They didn't see it when Jesus was blessing food and feeding 5,000 people. They didn't see it as Jesus was performing all sorts of miracles and curing people from illnesses and sicknesses. But when Jesus shows up walking on water, they know that Jesus is God. What a profound, fantastic way for God to show up. It's quite the opposite from our first lesson today. The lesson that talks about Elijah. Elijah, who also participated in tremendous works for God against the prophets of Baal, to the point that they now sought his life, and he goes and hides in the cave. And when the voice of the Lord comes, it doesn't come in the wind that breaks rocks. It doesn't come in the phenomenal storms. It doesn't come in the heavy downpours of rain. It comes when everything stops. Still, small, quiet. That's where Elijah hears the profound, tremendous voice of God speaking. In times that we're living in right now, I feel for teachers, students, parents, administrators. For once again, you step into school in a couple of days or a couple of weeks, and you do it all over again in a different way, sitting behind a desk, perhaps at home, in front of a screen. Parents who may have stretched to the limit with relationships, stressed with family issues, and you have to do it all over again. Teachers, some teachers who wind up in the classroom, maybe in a private school or in some other way, and having, or in colleges or universities, and having to be in personal contact, even if we do it safely, and teachers and students worried about COVID-19 and about infection and about how their lives will change. We have worries about our friends and our neighbors. What will happen to them as the new transition happens in Congress, as they provide for more stimulus relief? And will it be enough? And will it be effective? And what if the virus doesn't subside in the near future and that isn't enough? And what if, and what if, and what if? What if there's more social unrest? What if the political campaigns go awry and there's more screaming and yelling and fussing and fighting? What if? We feel sometimes like Elijah. We want to be in that cave. We want to go into our living room like my kids did when they were small and take a couple of big blankets and create some big cave and some hideout where we can go and hide from all the stuff that happens in life. But eventually we have to come out. Or we want to have some way that the Savior comes walking on the water of the chaos of our lives and grab hold of us when we jump in, or grab the boat that we're rowing and trying to live in. Sometimes we just have a hard time seeing. Jesus comes to the disciples in these bold ways. I pray that in the coming days and weeks, that you will be able to see and feel and know Jesus' presence in a big, bold way. Maybe it's the call from a friend that you haven't heard from in a while. Maybe it's in great news about a college acceptance. Maybe it's great news about a promotion. Or maybe it's great news that your job has been restored. And I pray that God comes to you in the stillness. And that still, small voice that says, hang in there. I'm right here with you. I'm crying the tears of despair. I'm trying to encourage you as best we can. Just know that God is present. Yesterday, we had the most awesome experience in the back courtyard of the church. Four, five, six of us stood around a baptismal font in the prayer garden. I dipped my hand in water three times and baptized Michael Everly in the name of the Father, Son, and the Spirit. And in a small, still way, Spirit came in those waters and grabbed hold of Michael in a way he cannot understand. And blessed him, his brother, his parents, and made a promise. The same promise that God makes to you and to me. That I will be there, God says. I will be there walking on the water in bold ways. I will be there whispering to you when you're hiding in the cave. Reminding you that I will always be present. I will never, ever leave you, God says. I will not forsake you in the midst of COVID, in the midst of politics, in the midst of social unrest, in the midst of school upheavals, in the midst of family stress, in the midst of life like we've never known it before. God will be present. And that little bit of faith that Jesus fussed at Peter about, that little bit of faith is what we will take. It's all we will need with Jesus' presence and the Spirit's action and God's love. That's all we will need to survive and to thrive as God's people. Amen.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Confident of God's care and helped by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. For your whole church throughout the world, give courage in the midst of storms, so that we see and hear Jesus calling, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." May we follow Christ wherever he leads. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the nations and their leaders, for those living in the aftermath of the explosion in Beirut, Lebanon, for those who struggle for food, shelter, and a place to call home, for all those around the world who live with the pain and grief afflicted by COVID-19, for doctors, nurses, medical staff who daily face new challenges in the face of this pandemic, for government leaders who make difficult decisions about health care and economics and safety, for researchers who are working tirelessly for a vaccine, and for families everywhere that they may have endurance and strength. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In you, steadfast love and faithfulness meet, O God, and righteousness and peace kiss. May leaders in our nation work toward peace that is the fruit of justice, and the justice that is the path to peace. Offer wisdom and patience to those with youthful passion. Reinvigorate an earlier generation with the enthusiasm for justice and equality and patience. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For those in need, everyone who calls upon your name will be saved. Accompany all who are lonely. Hear the voices of those who cry out in anguish, and support those who are frustrated in their search for an affordable place to live. We pray for those suffering this day, those who face illness or surgery or pain. Give strength to those who live with anxiety or loneliness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For our congregation, you continue to gather us through new ways as your people, and we thank you for ways that we can stay connected to you and to one another. We pray for those who are new to this community, for students and teachers preparing for a new school year, and for those struggling with unexpected hardships. Supply us generously with your grace for our life together. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Receive the blessing. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. So may God, the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, bless you and keep you in eternal love. Amen.
Offering forgiveness, comfort, and joy. Let nothing forgotten.
Thank you once again for joining us in worship at St. James Lutheran Church in Fayetteville on this 10th Sunday of Pentecost, August the 9th, 2020. We pray that you'll have a blessed week, that you'll be able to see God in bold, new, awesome ways, and you'll be able to hear God's voice in the stillness and the quiet moments as well. Receive. Go in peace. Christ is with you. Thanks be to God.